Hello everybody, welcome. So this is the Hindu summary for 30th Jan 2018 by me, Arpita Sharma. So starting with, guys, this is my Telegram channel. As you all know, this is a very clean channel. You can follow me on this channel for the PDFs, the important news, the mock mains answer writing questions, the mock prelims question, okay? And also you can follow me on Unacademy. This is my Unacademy profile, Arpita1994. You can follow me for various UPSC related courses over there. Starting with, now you all know that the economic survey 2018 is here, and the economic surveys it underscores the need to maintain fiscal credibility. This economic survey for 2017-18, it gives a different picture of an economy that gives reason for both optimism, the positivity and the caution. It also projects that GDP growth could accelerate to 7 to 7.5% in 2018-19 from current 6.75%. It would reinstate India as the world's fastest growing major economy. And according to our chief economic advisor, Mr. Arvind Subramaniam, the key factors contributing to the positive prognosis are the reform measures, that is the July 1 implementation of GST, as you all know, and the steps taken to address the twin balance sheet problem, that is the recapitalization of the banking sector. The latter includes the push to use the insolvency and bankruptcy code for debt resolution and the initiative to recapitalize public sector banks. And adding to these domestic enablers are the fair winds of a global recovery that have already lent a lift to overseas demand for India's goods and services. Now, the economic survey has used a very big data to get some, clear understanding of the economy. The data from the implementation of GST was combined with the availability of detailed new data from Employees Provident Fund Organization and Employees State Insurance Corporation. So this big data, guys, it was, combined with the, data or the information from the Employees Provident Fund Organization and ESIC as well. Now, this gives us a very, insightful knowledge about external and internal trade in the aggregate as well as state-wise manner. Also, the size and distribution of the tax net and levels of formality and informality have been given in this economic survey. Now, guys, secondly, the color of this year's survey cover was chosen as a symbol of support for the growing movement to end the violence against women. So this also is important for prelims. So the color of this year's survey, you have to tell me which color was it, and it symbolizes our support for the growing movement to end violence against women. There is a very deep societal meta preference in favor of sons, and empowering women with education and reproductive and economic agency are critical challenges for the Indian economy right now. Now, there were several important questions which were raised by the economic survey this year. First of all, the question was, why should we focus on the sex ratio of the last child? Secondly, do second and third tiers of government collect the direct taxes that they are empowered to? Third, can we expect the current investment slowdown to reverse quickly based on an understanding other countries' experience? Then, under what conditions, to what extent or to what limit, and where will the agricultural impact of climate change be most felt, including the farming sector? Should the government and judiciary agree to a cooperative separation of powers like the center and the states do? Should there be a number of science and technology missions to propel India to the rank of the world's top knowledge producers? So these were the questions which were raised by the economic survey this year. Now, page 1, recovery will lift growth to 7.75%. So the survey, the economic survey, which was, tabled by Finance Minister Arun Jaitley in Parliament on Monday, this economic survey, it predicted that GDP growth in the current financial year would touch 6.75%, higher than the 6.5% estimated by CSO. Now, economic survey, it says the effects of, the note ban GST have receded. Also, the economy is set to grow at 7 to 7.5% in the coming fiscal year, right? Reform measures like the implementation of, IBC, that is the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, and the recapitalization plan of the public sector banks, it would go long way in addressing in resolving the twin balance sheet problem, that is the NPA problem, which afflicts both corporates and banks, and it would also in further, you know, it would turn or it would boost economic growth. The economic survey also gave measures of caution about points of caution about some ongoing trends. For example, the rising oil prices and stock market prices. These, you know, two issues will require vigilance and inspection and preventive action. Policy vigilance will be necessary in the coming year, especially if high international oil prices, they, you know, persist or the elevated stock prices, you know, correct sharply, provoking a sudden stall in capital flows. Now, the government also has several policy actions now in the economic survey, and it will, you know, they will take place in the next financial year, and they will also include completing the reforms needed to effectively resolve the ailing balance sheet of corporates and banks, and also finalizing the privatization of Air India, which is going on. And also, guys, in the medium term, the survey highlighted three areas which will require policy focus or policy vigilance, including employment, education and agriculture. Now, the indirect taxpayer count rises. So, what were the findings of the economic survey? First of all, the economic survey said that the GST has resulted in a 50% increase in the number of indirect taxpayers. And the tax regime has revealed a new data on the important areas such as interstate trade, state-wise exports, extent of formalization in the economy. So the data showed that GST had resulted in a significant boost up or increase in voluntary compliance, and 1.7 million registrants, you know, who were below the threshold annual turnover limit of rupees 20 lakh, they chose to register for GST nevertheless. Other findings of the survey were that GST data has showed that the formal sector in India was larger than earlier, and India's internal trade is about 60% of GDP. Okay. Climate change may hit the farm income. So guys, the technology like drip irrigation, they, you know, hold special key or special, you know, way to future of agriculture, replace power subsidy with DBT. So economic survey 2017-18, it said that the farmer income losses from climate change, they could be between 15% to 18% on average, rising to anywhere between 20 to 25% in unirrigated areas of the country. So this is a, you know, point of caution. So applying the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, it predicted temperatures and projecting India's recent trends in precipitation, and also assuming no policy responses to give rise to estimate for farm income losses of 15 to 18%. Rising to 20 to 25% for unirrigated areas. It pointed out, you know, the survey, adding that at current levels of farm income, that translates into more than rupees 3,600 per year for the medium farm household. So Prime Minister's goal of doubling farmers' income, increasingly it runs up against the contemporary realities. Our Prime Minister said that his goal is doubling farmers' income, which we studied in previous the Hindu summary. But looking at, you know, at the current scenario, the realities, the contemporary realities of Indian agriculture and the harsher prospect of its vulnerability to long-term climate changes, it is, you know, far from, you know, what Prime Minister said. And also it was pointed out in the survey as well, adding that India needed to expand irrigation and do so against the backdrop of rising water scarcity and depleting groundwater resources. In the 1960s, guys, less than 20% of agriculture was irrigated. Now, this number is in the mid-40s. The Indo-Gangetic Plain and parts of Gujarat and MP, they are well irrigated, right? But some parts of Karnataka, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand, they are still at this point of time extremely vulnerable to climate change on account of not being well irrigated. So fully irrigating Indian agriculture, that too against the, you know, backdrop of water scarcity and limited efficiency in existing irrigation schemes, it will be a defining challenge for the near future. Technologies like drip irrigation, sprinklers, water management, they captured in the More Crop for Every Drop campaign, they may well hold the key to future Indian agriculture. So the survey also added that power subsidy needs to be replaced by direct benefit transfers, that is the DBT, so that power use can be fully costed and water conservation can be fully furthered. Extreme temperature shocks reduce farmer incomes by 4.3% and 4.1% during both Kharif and Rabi seasons. And you know, it is not clear when direction farm revenue, you know, revenues should move in which direction the farm revenues should move in on the one hand. And these you know, temperature shocks, they reduce the yields, the output also. But on the other, the lower supply should increase local prices. So the results here clearly, they depict that the supply shock dominates right now. Reductions in yields lead to reduced revenues according to the findings of the survey. So the survey also observed that while thinking about agricultural policy and reforms in India, it's very important to make a clear line between two agricultures in India. So there is an agriculture, the well-irrigated input added one, and price and procurement supported cereals which are grown in northern India, where the challenge, where the, you know, main hurdle is for policy to change the form of the very generous support from prices and subsidies to less damaging support in the form of DBTs. On the other hand, there is another agriculture. This was the first agriculture was, it was well irrigated input added and price and procurement supported agriculture. Okay, but on the other hand, the another agriculture, which is also known as non-cereals in central, western and southern India, where the problems are very different, such as inadequate irrigation, you know, rain dependence, ineffective procurement, insufficient investment in research and technology, etc. Okay, so this is another type of, you know, agriculture which poses as a challenge on the economic policy. Now, diamonds make the cut with domestic investors. So, ICEX, it's the world's first diamond futures contract to provide exporters with a hedging tool. And also this ICEX, it offers various trading in diamonds of two sizes. So, two sizes of diamonds, they invoke trading. First is 50 cents and second is 1 carat. And 1 carat equals 100 cents, okay? Now, ICEX will offer also HVS2 quality diamond, which are certified by the International Institute of Diamond Grading and Research. Okay. Now, what is the statistics in India? So, India is the world's third largest diamond consumer, guys. Okay. And India imports rough diamond worth $19 billion and exports polished ones valued $24 billion annually. India is also a global diamond polishing hub where 14 out of every 15 rough diamonds in the world are polished. Okay, so these facts are very important for your prelims, right? Do remember these facts. Now, what is this ICEX, Indian Commodity Exchange Limited? Indian Commodity Exchange Limited, it is basically a nationwide online trading platform in commodity derivative. So all the commodities are traded on this platform. Okay. It has put in place grading and vaulting facilities in order to facilitate deliveries. And this exchange is ideally, it is positioned to, you know, increase the huge potential of commodities market. Okay, and encourage participation of actual users to benefit from the opportunities of hedging, risk management, supply chain management in the derivatives market. Okay, so do remember that this ICEX, it is a public-private partnership. Okay, now what is the background information of this news? First of all, diamond mining in India, it extends back into antiquity. Like from ancient times, it has been done. India was the only source of nearly all the world's known diamonds. Okay, but it was the source of, you know, all the world's known diamonds until the discovery of diamonds in Brazil in 1726. जब तक ब्राज़ील में ये diamonds की discovery नहीं हुई थी, तब तक इंडिया ही एक ऐसी country थी जहाँ पर जाने माने पूरी दुनिया के जो diamonds थे वो इंडिया में पाए जाते थे. India was the only place where diamonds were mined. Okay. So, diamond deposits occur in three types of geological settings, such as kimberlite pipes, conglomerate beds, and alluvial gravels. Prelims ke liye ye bahut bahut important hai. Now, the main diamond bearing areas in India are, do remember this, Panna Belt in Madhya Pradesh, then Munimudugu and Banaganapalli conglomerate in Kurnool district. Then Vajra Karur Kimberlite Pipe in Anantapur district, the gravels of Krishna River Basin in Andhra Pradesh, and Diamondiferous Kimberlite in Raipur, Bastar and Raigarh districts in Chhattisgarh. And the reserves, diamond reserves have been estimated in Panna Belt, Madhya Pradesh, Krishna gravels in Andhra Pradesh, and in Raipur district, Chhattisgarh. And as per the UNFC system, on, you know, 1st April 2005, diamonds are placed at around 4,582,000 carats, out of which about 1206,000 cadets are under reserve category, and the remaining are under the, you know, remaining resources category. Okay. Now, President PM called for early passage of Triple Talaq Bill. So, President Mr. Ramnath Kovind and our Prime Minister Modi, they advocated the early passage of the Muslim protection, the Muslim Women Protection of Rights and Marriage Bill 2017, which is also famously known as the Triple Talaq Bill, during the budget session. Now, Mr. Modi, he made remarks and comments before the start of the session, and Mr. Kovind made it a part of his address to both the houses. The bill had been cleared by the Lok Sabha in December last year, okay, but it is hanging fire in the Rajya Sabha, where, you know, the opposition groups, they want the bill to be sent to a select committee for further scrutiny and checking. Okay. Now, in the customary address to the media outside the Parliament House, Mr. Modi, he said that it was government's effort as well as the expectation of people as well, that there should be no politics on the important issues like Triple Talaq, and that Muslim women would get their rights soon. Next, government has curbed inflation, Kovind. So, Honorable President Mr. Ramnath Kovind, he said on the first day of the budget session that his speech focused on ensuring social justice and economic democracy, right? So, he, you know, reflected very important areas. He mentioned about giving the highest, you know, importance to agriculture, dignity for women by building toilets, then providing cooking gas connection, improving the maternity benefits, and expressing hope that the Triple Talaq ban, the bill on Triple Talaq ban becomes a law. Now, talking about the economy, he also mentioned that the government had been able to, you know, stop the inflation and fiscal deficit in the past 3.5 years. And he also highlighted foreign exchange reserves in excess of $410 billion as a very important achievement of the government. Now, the president also said that appropriate policies of government, they ensured that foreign investment increased from $36 billion to $60 billion during this period. UP to set up 6,000 plants to meet clean energy target. So this new policy of the department, that is the Uttar Pradesh Solar Power Policy 2017, this new policy is available on the internet and anyone can go through this policy. And the policy, it has made, you know, it has been made after serious meetings, serious deliberations with all the stakeholders and incorporating their suggestions to the maximum possible limit. The Uttar Pradesh government is now setting up 6,000 solar power plants to meet its clean energy target of 10,700 megawatt. Okay, so Uttar Pradesh has a solar energy potential of 22,300 megawatt, and the state intends to harness this potential to meet the solar power generation target of 10,700 megawatt. Okay, so guys, also, ever since the formation of the Department of New and Renewable Energy, that is the Vaikalpik Urya Vibhag, in 1985, no attention was paid to it. जब से ये department बना है तब से इसको अब तक कोई attention नहीं दी गई है. But the department was always considered as a vaikalpik, that is, vaikalpik means optional one. But now, after the formation of Mr. Yogi Adityanath's government in Uttar Pradesh, department is, you know, has started getting due priority. Okay. Now, major relief to solar energy consumers. First of all, if anyone installs the solar rooftop panels to produce electricity, then he will be exempted from taking a non-objection certificate. Okay. And the earlier practice was that officials of Power Safety Directorate, they would inspect and then give the NOC. But now, if anyone installs the solar rooftop panels to produce electricity, then he will be exempted from taking this NOC. Solar panels have been designed in such a way that they will provide uninterrupted power for 25 years, and the government appealed to people to purchase such panels. Now, the authorities will also provide transmission lines up to 15 kilometers for this solar energy plants. Okay. Now, the Uttar Pradesh Solar Power Policy 2017, it targets the implementation of 10,700 megawatt of grid connected solar power projects by the end of 2022. Okay. A morale booster for women army officers. So guys, what has happened is that according to some officials, on implementation of the recommendation of the Ajay Vikram Singh Committee, the government in 2004, it had accepted the, you know, promotions of the army officers. The government, on the recommendation of this particular committee, accepted the promotion of army officers at 2, 6 and 13 years of service to the ranks of captain, major and lieutenant colonel respectively. Okay. Now, though the promotions were made applicable to all the commissioned officers, but the benefit was later withheld from short service and women officers. Why? Because of an internal interpretation by the army's military secretary's branch. Now, these benefits of, promotions, they were not extended despite a gazetted notification by the Ministry of Defense extending the same to all the affected officers. Later in 2006, guys, when the short service scheme was changed from 5 plus 5 plus 4 year system from this 10 plus 4 year system, sorry, to this 10 plus 4 year system, the benefit was duly extended to those officers only who opted for the new scheme, which resulted in a sharp disparity, where senior officers were being retired as substantive lieutenants and the captains, while the juniors were reaching the rank of lieutenant colonel. So this discrimination was set aside by the Armed Forces Tribunal, but the decision was challenged in the Supreme Court by the Army and the MOD. Okay. Now, in this particular news, the relief has been given to more than 150 women army officers. Ministry of Defense, led by Nirmala Sitharaman, withdrew its appeal related to the issue of denial of these commissioning of promotions and benefit to short service and women commissioned officers, which were commissioned before 2006. Okay. Now, according to the officials, the decision for withdrawal was approved last week by Sitharaman, and on Monday also, the appeal was finally withdrawn from the Supreme Court. An advocate, Aishwarya Bhatti, she is the counsel appearing for women officers. She said that the matter stands resolved now with the Ministry of Defence, that is the MOD, withdrawing its appeal filed against such officers. Now, open to talk with India on CPEC. So, China has offered the open talks, the deliberations with India to solve the differences on China-Pakistan economic corridor now. And this has also opened the doors for removing a major irritant in New Delhi, Beijing ties. Now, what is China offering in this talk? First of all, it can change the name of CPEC. China has also offered to create an alternative corridor through Jammu and Kashmir, Nathula Pass or Nepal to deal with the India's concern. And why China is offering this? First of all, India has objected to CPEC because CPEC passes through Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and it's a violation of its sovereignty, right? And also, guys, CPEC is a part of China's ambitious Belt and Road Initiative, right? Now, what is the China's present stand on Doklam? China reiterated its stock response that Doklam, that is Donglang, it was China's sovereign territory. And Beijing had the right to build infrastructure in the area. This is China's stand. The Sikkim section of China-India boundary, it has been demarcated by historical treaty and is under effective jurisdiction by China. And China will as always uphold its sovereignty along the border area, including Donglang, which is Doklam. Electric vehicles charging infrastructure needs a jolt to meet 2030 target. So government is planning on the target to achieve an all electric fleet of vehicles by 2030. And this will need a substantial boost from the government and the private sector as well in terms of, infrastructure, cheaper availability of raw materials, incentivizing midway measures, for example, hybrid vehicles, right? Now, what are the steps which have been taken? First of all, different departments and ministries, they have come up with their engagement with the electric vehicle industry. The Energy Efficiency Services Limited, which is a government firm, it has put in motion plans to procure this 10,000 e-vehicles. And the government also notified the scheme for FAME and, as a part of its National Electric Mobility Mission Plan 2020. The scheme has four focus areas. First is technology development, second is pilot project, third charging infrastructure, and fourth is demand creation. And this particular scheme has been extended until March 31st, 2018. So the center has begun pilot projects in this regard.